So the main place you're going to see prefixes is when you're working with objects. So let's play around with that a little bit. The first tool we're going to look at is getting some information about an object. And this is done via the statObject method. It gives you all the details about when an object was uploaded and all that other fun stuff. The call is very simple. It's just statObject with a bucket name and then an object name. And of course, if you have a prefix, that optional prefix. The result that you get back is an object, but it's not an object write result object. That said, it does have some of the same fields, and in our lab code, that rprint method that I wrote for you, you can still use that to get the object name, the last modification date, and some other fun stuff. A little more interesting is copying an object. The copyObject method uses a CopySource object to take an object and copy it into a new destination. This is a little different from what we've seen before. So when I do this copy, I need to give it the bucket, a destination prefix, and an object, and then the copy source also gets a bucket and a source and object. This result is an object write result just like anything else, so we can work with that the way we have before. But the interesting thing is this copy source object. It's interesting that when we do a copy object, we need to give it the full source. And there could be a different bucket even that it's coming from. But for our purposes, the main difference is going to be the source prefix and the destination prefix. There are a number of additional fields that the copy source object can take. Let's take a look at that. Within the copy source arguments, are not only the bucket name and the object name, but if there is a region that it's stored in or a version that it's stored with, you can supply that as well. Probably the most interesting stuff for this copy source reference is the fact that you can match e-tags. And again, this is for optimistic concurrency. There's also a modified since or an unmodified since, which makes this a very valuable tool for an offsite backup or a backup to a separate MinIO cluster, because you can automatically select based on the modification date which items you're actually going to copy over. So you could use the same backup code and just make sure you're only getting new versions of the object with that modified since. There's also an offset and a length that you can use to copy just a subset of whatever object you're actually copying. You don't have to copy every byte over. You can give it an offset byte and a length byte. When you're deleting an object, you're going to do this remove object. It just deletes the requested object based on the bucket and the object name. There's no return type, and if the object to be deleted doesn't exist, you're not going to get an error. It's not considered an error if you're trying to delete something that already isn't there. So that can be a little interesting when you're doing a remove. Last, there's this concept of moving an object, and it turns out there is no move. If you're going to move an object, first you need to copy it, and then you need to delete the original. So it's always going to be this two-step process to move an object. So there it is, copying an object from our source prefix using the copy source, and then copying it over. Again, the remove object is simply do the bucket, source, prefix, and object to remove it. What you're going to want to do is check that result. Make sure that the copy actually worked before you do the remove object. So that may be where your if statement comes in. If you want to delete a prefix, recall that I mentioned to delete a prefix, it's automatically created and therefore also automatically deleted. So in order to delete that prefix, is you simply remove all the objects from the prefix and then MinIO will get rid of the prefix automatically for you. So in order to do this, you'll use list objects and also remove objects. And then there's also a delete object class that you want to use when you're going to remove all objects from a prefix. Keep in mind that there's no concept of removing a prefix via the SDK. Now that said, if you go into the console and you see a prefix, you can click delete on that prefix. But what's going to happen behind the scenes is it's just going to delete all the objects from the prefix. There's the link to the remove objects documentation. Let's take a look at an example. Here we have this delete object list, and it's a simple Python map. We're using a simple lambda function to basically list all of the objects in a particular prefix. Now notice, this list objects takes the bucket name and a prefix. So this is a case where you might see a prefix without an actual object name. And then we're doing a recursive true to make sure that we're getting all of the objects. Each one of the objects in that list objects will then be used to create a delete object object, which is then used in a bucket name to delete all of the objects. Now notice, we say we have a prefix here. It turns out all of those prefixes will be part of the object name used in the delete object. And so that object list is really a list of individual objects that we're deleting, prefix and all. When you run remove objects, you may get a list of errors if something goes wrong. And so you probably want to take a look at your errors if any happen to happen during this process. But it's list objects and remove objects. Note the plural there. It's not just remove object. Here's the delete object reference. Really what you're looking at is just the name. Notice that there's no bucket that we're dealing with here. And then there's an optional version ID if you're dealing with versioning.